All right. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Meet the Leaders of the Startup Nation session. My name is Keren Elazari. I'll be your host this morning on this nonstop flight to Tel Aviv. So you got really lucky today. Instead of a 16-hour flight from San Francisco to Tel Aviv, you're getting that quick 45-minute session with the leaders of the Startup Nation. I invite all of you to come forward, join us, come closer to the stage if you like. We promise not to make fun of our audience. This is a conversation, and we do love having you guys with us near, and we'll have time for your questions. I also will put up a Twitter hashtag and my own Twitter handle so you can send questions to me, and towards the end of the session, I'll open up to get some of those questions from Twitter. That way we can also continue the conversation, so if you have further questions to our leaders, you can catch up with them on Twitter or with me afterwards. And without further ado, I'd like to start by inviting our esteemed panelists to the stage, and I'll go one by one, and as they come up to the stage, please give them a warm welcome as I introduce them. So first up, we have Professor Isaac Ben Israel. Yes, please do join me here. Thank you very much. And Isaac Ben Israel, or as I call him, Itzik, is kind of my boss at Tel Aviv University's ICRC, Interdisciplinary Research Center, where he leads the interdisciplinary research work. We have more than 200 different researchers working on different really interesting cybersecurity topics back at Tel Aviv University. Professor Ben Israel is also the head of the Yuval Ne'eman Workshop for Science, Technology, and Security. But more importantly for today's discussion, for the past 6 years, he has served as the closest advisor to our prime minister on all national cybersecurity issues. And in fact, it was his discussions, a work group, and a national effort that he led that got the government to start our National Cyber Bureau and National Cyber Directorate. And with that, that brings me to our second guest today, Mr. Nir Peleg. Please give him a warm, warm welcome. So Nir is actually the head of the R&D division with the Israeli National Cyber Directorate. And in that role, he leads a lot of the international and internal development and partnership capacities, including the setting up of the Israeli National CERT, which is a super important effort for us, and we hope to learn a little bit from what you've achieved in the past 2 years, and working on information sharing collaboration efforts with Israeli security companies and with international partners. He also has a background. He actually went to a school here in the United States, I believe, and here's a little anecdote about Nir so you can get to know him a little bit better. So in Israel, it's almost always sunny, and we don't get a lot of snow, but Nir likes to ski. So this week in California, he's also hoping to get some sunshine and some hours on the slopes. And I think we all could use a weekend like that, couldn't we? So thanks, Nir, for joining us. All right, now next up, we have really some of the most globally recognized leaders of the Israeli startup industry. And I'm really proud, really happy to have them with us today. First up, please give a super warm welcome to Udi Mokadi. Udi, please, please join us. Udi is the chairman of the board and the CEO of CyberArk. If you don't know CyberArk, you've probably been living under a stone in the past 10 years because they are one of the most important security companies coming out of Israel and has become more than a unicorn. It's actually worth, I think, $8 billion or something like that. Less? Okay. Well, this is not investment advice, don't worry. But they do work with more than 50% of the Fortune 100 companies who use their technology. And Udi's been with CyberArk from the beginning, and he's going to tell us about moving an Israeli startup to the US. They actually have headquarters in Massachusetts, and we learn a little bit about his experience there. And last, but absolutely not least, in fact, he might be the man that you've all been hearing about, or maybe hearing stories about him only with his first letter of his name. This is Mr. Nadav Tzafrir, former commander of 8200, probably the most prestigious elite Israeli intelligence technology unit, probably the name that you think about when you think about Israeli cybersecurity and innovation, you'll think about 8200. Now, Nadav is no longer with 8200, now he leads Team 8, which is probably the leading foundry, an organization that sets up entrepreneurs and experts with funding from people like Eric Schmidt from Google, who recently invested in his Team 8 endeavors. And they are actually launching some of the most innovative, interesting cybersecurity companies from Israel that you haven't heard of yet. So the next big thing is definitely going to come out of the teammates foundry. And I'm so, so happy to have you guys here with us. I think you audience really lucked out this morning. We have some of the greatest leaders of the startup nation, and we can get started with our conversation. So guys, I'd like you to kind of feel comfortable, and actually our audience as well, if you have coffee or water, feel free to drink that, because what we'd like to do this morning is really, I'd like our session to be kind of your morning espresso shot, for those of you who didn't get the coffee, to get some ideas, really fast-paced theme, a conversation, and we will like to hear from you. As promised, you can find me on Twitter, K3R3N3, and you can send me some questions. And in fact, if you'd like to use a hashtag, feel free, but I'll just be monitoring Twitter during our conversation, and we'll try to respond to your questions as well. So let's just get started. I want to have like one general question for our panelists to get you guys warmed up and to get us to know you a little better. Everybody's heard about the Israeli startup success stories, and if you haven't heard about them yet, it's time, we'll tell you all about it. But what is it about the collaboration ecosystem between industry companies like CyberArk, for example, government organizations like the National Cyber Directorate, and universities and academics and leaders such as yourself, Professor Ben Israel? How does this collaboration actually work uniquely in Israel? I'd love to hear one specific example, if you guys can give me, of something that happens differently in Israel that you haven't seen in other places. Any thoughts on that? Nir, would you like to jump in?
Yeah. Yeah, thank you, and good morning. Since 2012, I think strategic decision of the government decided to actually establish an organization that will push not only the cybersecurity defense, but also to work strongly and collaboratively on the cybersecurity infrastructure and innovation opportunity, threats and opportunity together on the single place. Now, a very unique collaboration had been since then happening, and one of them, as an example, I would like to mention is actually establishing research centers within the academy that actually with the threefold objectives. First is...
Can you give us an example? Are you talking about the CyberSpark, for example?
No, I'm talking about the research center within the university.
Okay.
CyberSpark, I'll talk later in another example. But the research centers, for example, there are three main objectives. One is long-term, to put long-term budget for about 5 years. Second, to create a critical mass of knowledge hub within the universities that will attract also outside the researcher from many disciplines to the work on the cyber challenges. And third, to boost the collaboration between the academy and the industry. Now, the model that we are built is matching government fund with a non-government fund around these universities. And actually, the pioneering research center was started by Ben Israel in Tel Aviv University, the Interdisciplinary Cyber Research Center. And
Let's give the audience some numbers, if you can. I believe there was a private endowment from a private benefactor and a national commitment to match the same funds to support the effort in the university.
Yeah, so currently, right now, we're investing in five research centers across the country. In a total, including the matching of $60 million.
So $60 million from the government and $60 million
from... No, 30 and 30.
Okay, 30
totally
and 30.
In five research centers, Tel Aviv, Ben Gurion University, the Bar Ilan, Technion, and the Hebrew University, which are the cutting leading universities, and very interesting things are happening there with open research.
Very cool. Work. Thanks for the reference, Nir. Do you guys want to jump in on that?
Or? Sure.
Yeah, go ahead, Nadav.
Actually, I don't know if this works.
Yes.
Does it work? So let me give you something which is completely different.
Please do.
Which is coming down. I don't know if you know, but we have a direct flight from Tel Aviv to San Francisco now.
And we're very happy about it.
We're very happy about it. And most of the deals are done on the plane.
So it's the new nerd bird.
Yeah, exactly. It's a new nerd bird. I'm coming down here, but apropos nerd bird, and I think it gives you a little bit of a taste of how we close things in within government, tech, universities, and so forth. So on the plane down here in my cabin, I had the former head of the Intel, the former chief of staff, the CEO and founder of one of the Israel's unicorn with all his team, one of the leaders of Checkpoint, and we were all stuck in the same cabin, and it was a night flight. But
I'm starting to feel bad for you, Nadav.
Right.
I'm sure it was a pretty good flight because you came out with some ideas, deals,
exactly. And so we were talking, and then all of a sudden the stewardess came over and said, "You know, guys, you're making a lot of noise, and people are trying to sleep." I'm looking around, and the only people who are trying to sleep are the stewardess. all this group, I just looked at it, and it was interesting, because all this group, doesn't matter that one of them is a major general or a three-star general or somebody that served as a lieutenant or wasn't even an officer in one of these organizations, they all came from the same place, the same melting pot, and it saves a lot of time. When one is a developer, one used to be a three-star general and now is running a startup, one is the CEO of a major organization, which is a billion-dollar enlisted company on NASDAQ. And all of these people just happened to meet by chance on the plane, and now they spent a few hours talking to each other, you know, laughing at each other, telling each other success stories and failure stories and collaborating, and things move. And I think as entrepreneurs, and you know, I'm a novice at entrepreneurship. I've been doing it for 3 years because I spent most of my time in the military as well. But what I do realize is how difficult it is to be an entrepreneur, and how and the one thing that you don't have is time.
Yeah, you don't have time to burn.
Time and dollars, and probably in that order. The fact that you can meet like that across levels of the organization, government, universities, in one plane by mistake. And get three things done on the way while you're doing your emails. And the only guys that weren't happy were the stewardess. They couldn't get to sleep.
So maybe we can't get United Airlines to sponsor our next conference in Tel Aviv.
But so
I'd love
angle.
To get them on board, though. But I agree with you, Nadav. But what you're saying is basically it's the unmediated direct connection. The fact that we can have all of you here and you have all met each other before and you know each other and I've met you. So it's not just on the flight. It's just a general sense that you can approach people, I think, in Israel, regardless of whether they were a general or a captain or a developer. Everybody can just have a conversation.
Yeah, everybody can have a conversation. Everybody knows everybody. The rule about being a few times removed doesn't work in Israel. There are no you're not removed from everybody. So this smashing of people from different places, academia, government, military, startups, big companies, all working together, all intertwined, talking to each other, and at the end of the day, coming from the same melting pot, because they're not different states or different universities. They're all in the same state.
Yeah.
And they all came from the same military, and so it makes things faster.
Let me give the audience a reference. So how many of you have actually are from, I see a few people, a few friendly faces from Israel. How many of you have been, let's do it easier. How many people have not been to Israel? Okay,
wow.
Quite a bunch of you. All right, so at the end of the talk, I'll also extend an invitation to visit Tel Aviv, and you can take the direct flight or any other flight that you like.
And Jerusalem.
Close some deals on the way.
Yes.
Close some deals.
So this is the reference I wanted to give you. Maybe you don't know this, but here in Silicon Valley, San Francisco and Mountain View or Palo Alto or Berkeley are pretty much within an hour or two drive time. That's the same thing in Israel as well. So Jerusalem, Beersheba, Tel Aviv, Haifa, most of these places are within an hour, sometimes less, of a ride from one another. So it is a very, very close ecosystem where we do get to meet people, we have really interesting discussions. And within that small ecosystem, we have a lot of great ideas. So with that, I want to move on to the next question. And Udi, this one's for you, because this is about one of the most well-known, perhaps, myth, or one of the beliefs about Israeli startups, is that a lot of Israeli startups either end up, most of them either get up acquired by a very big company, or they move on and they become something else, and a failed entrepreneur in Israel just becomes a serial entrepreneur and moves on to his next startup. So it's the belief that a lot of the Israeli startups, especially in cybersecurity, are not really aiming for the IPO are not really aiming to become that next big company. We don't have a lot of them, but we do have Checkpoint as one example, Imperva is another great example, and CyberArk, which definitely broke that mold. It didn't become acquired by another company. You actually went big and you went with the IPO. So how did you break this pattern? If you can share with us your story.
And I agree with you that there was a myth that Israelis are good in the product side and the innovation, but then they sell the company quick. When we founded CyberArk, we found inspiration in the existence of Checkpoint that went global and went after the world, so we knew it can happen. And then the customers really affected us because customers said, hey, you're mission critical software, we want you to be around. And they emphasized it a couple of times.
Don't get sold.
And it happened often and often again, and we felt that we're onto something real. We embraced the world, as we'll talk about, and we went after the long and harder road, but very fulfilling, and hopefully we're an inspiration for smaller companies today.
I think you are absolutely an inspiration, Udi, and thank you so much for saying that. Also, another interesting fact that we'll touch on later is that Udi moved the headquarters of CyberArk to the United States, but it still really remains an Israeli company in its DNA, and we'll touch on that soon. But I'm curious also to hear the audience, and if you guys have some maybe legends that you've heard about cybersecurity, or maybe you're not sure if something is a myth or is it true, why don't you send those questions to us on Twitter, and you can use the hashtag or my Twitter handle, and we'll be sure to get back to you on that. And I think this is a conversation that also needs to be had. So you can have the details up there on the screen. Please feel free to send us those questions during the session. And is any other myth that you want to bust for us today? Any other thing that people believe about Israeli cybersecurity but is actually not true or is different?
Maybe I'll take one myth. I think I heard that many of the people here think that most of the entrepreneurship in Israel come from the military defense organization. And actually the right number that we know is that only 25% of them are directly going out for the military and defense organization. And the interesting point in that is that the two main sources is that, first of all, big companies, established companies, InfoSec industry, that people get going out to do some entrepreneurship from these companies. And the second is
by... So you mean a company like RSA, for example, that has big R&D presence in Israel?
Yeah,
or
RSA, multinationals, also
IBM.
Big companies like Checkpoint and CyberArk, that people are going out after several years to do some entrepreneurship. And this is one source. The second source is actually people that within the last 15 years, we have dealt a lot within the government and, of course, with our companies regarding how to secure better the critical infrastructure in Israel. Mm. For these challenges, the experience and people that work in the government and form companies created new solutions and experience that went out also to the private sector.
Absolutely, I agree with you, Nir, and it's a good point. So people believe that it's just kids go to the army, they're done at 21, and then they start a company. That's true, but that's not where all the innovation, all the big success stories happen. So Itzik and maybe Nir also, or Udi and Anav, if you'd like to jump in, I'm curious to hear more about the government, how the government's decisions, how your advisory work with the prime minister, how does that shape or influence the innovation ecosystem? How does that create the opportunities to come up with new solutions? How does the government really influence startups? Could you comment on that?
I'll try.
Please try.
First of all, the governments generally can really kill every good idea if they are not careful enough. So the first thing to do is to know what is really the goal. Let's take, for example, cybersecurity. The goal, the Israeli defined goal of cybersecurity ecosystem is not necessarily security. And this is something that one must understand. If it was only security, we could do other things. We already had, for example, we already had a government agency which took care of cyber protection of critical infrastructures more than 15 years ago. Mm. This one can do without this noise around cybers. The goal of cyber technology, I would call it, in Israel, is to really develop the economy, the knowledge-based society, and things like this. Once you understand it, there are several things that you have to, not to touch in a way, but only to encourage the ecosystem to work by itself, and I think this is what we did. Now you ask for success story, the main success story is the success story of the whole country in this respect. Last year we had Israeli export of cybersecurity products and services was something close to 10% of the global market, and not many of you visited Israel, but you know that we are not 10% of anything else. My wife says, by the way, the problems, but perhaps, I don't know.
10% of the problem, maybe we got a little bit more than 10% on that one.
And if you look on more important figures, like the share of Israel cybersecurity R&D from the global globally is close to 20%. It was published, just published by Bloomberg. Between 15 to 20% of the investment in R&D, in cyber R&D. We have more than 800 companies. 500 of them were set up in the last 5 years. Now, what is really impressive is if you compare, let's say, 2016 to 2011, in which we initiated this whole move, and it is a growth of 400% in 5 years in terms of export, investment in R&D, number of companies, number of people involved, etc. And this was done not by inventing new regulations and new rules and new tools, but by understanding what really may prevent it and trying to
get rid of the problem.
Get rid of the obstacles.
So nurturing, the government's role in this case is more nurturing and facilitating and opening doors rather than, you know, prescribing regulation or putting obstacles in the path of entrepreneurs. And I recently read a comparison between how easy it is to start a company and run a company in, I think, Israel, Europe, and the United States. I wouldn't say Israel was at the top, but it was definitely at a pretty good place, especially if you compare it to some more heavily regulated places, like, for example, Germany, where, you know, established business practices are very different. So if you're a security or any type of startup or entrepreneur in Germany, for example, and you go out of business, you might have criminal responsibility or liability because your employees are now out of a job. Whereas in Israel, if you start a company and you fail, you are probably better off in the next funding round from your investors. And one could think this is a little bit irresponsible, but I think it's part of our, you know, try, fail fast, and learn from your mistakes. And with that in mind, actually, we know that there is a global need for lots more security professionals. And I'd love to hear a little bit from the panel's rich experience with this, especially with nurturing talent and creating that atmosphere that you can try, you can fail, you can challenge higher ups authority. And I also like to respond to a question that we got from the audience. So a member in the audience said that she would like to know how the Israeli military experience also can perhaps be more inclusive for women into the industry, or how women's role is different in Israel. And I'd like to, if you guys can also point out how the work that you've done in startups and the military has actually opened up pathways into this industry for more people. And I can share my own personal story if that's of interest as well. I can tell you that when I joined the Army when I was 18, I already was a hacker, I was already interested in cybersecurity, and throughout the vetting process and the clearance and going through these tests and trials that kids go through in Israel, at the age of 16, 17, I was already tested for my aptitude. I would already, you know, be in a position to tell the people that are talking to me, I want to be in cybersecurity in the Army. I want to find that unit. And they were able to get me there. But once I got there, I still had to challenge authority all the time. And at one time, I even came up to the commander of my unit, which was, I think, lieutenant general. So maybe not at the rank of Udi and Isaac, but one rank below that, but a pretty top rank, and I was just an enlisted soldier. But I was able to challenge his authority on an issue. I came up to him with a security problem I found, and instead of sending me for court-martial for jumping up the chain of command, he actually gave me an opportunity to do a pilot project in one of the Israeli military's computer units to show him what I was capable of. And that was a great, very, very important break for me. So I'd like to hear a little bit about how talent, how you nurture talent in the Israeli ecosystem, and how we create this atmosphere to try, to fail, and to get more types of people also into the industry as well.
If I can just jump on the
please, Udi.
The women inclusiveness question, I think the military, because it recruits both men and women at the same time, actually creates an opportunity to introduce more women into the IT industry and cybersecurity specifically. We're very proud of a specific number at CyberArk. I think the industry number is typically 10 to 15% of R&D will be women. At CyberArk, it's 35%. So it's not 50%, but it's 35%, probably double the industry. And it's not even an issue. You walk around the hall, of course, we have many women developers and managers.
I agree with you. So mandatory service in Israel, at the age of 18, we all serve. Men, women, doesn't matter. For me, it was extremely equalizing. And I think maybe other countries, you don't have mandatory service yet, but it could be a good idea. What do you think about that, Nadav? Is that the secret sauce, mandatory service, just draft everybody and get the best people?
Actually, I think so, yeah. I think mandatory service is a key because, as you said, counterintuitively, it's an equalizer that allows everybody at the age of 16, 17, 18 to start again, regardless of where they were born, regardless of what school they went to. Honestly, mostly it's a merit-based exercise where when you're 16, you start getting tested. I think the key about the testing is that there's not much you can ask people when they're 16 about what they know because, you know, they're kids in high school.
You'd be surprised what some kids in high school can do right now, you know. Some of the best hackers I know are definitely under 18.
Yeah, but honestly, the thing that you really want to do is try to predict what they can learn very, very fast. Mm. And if you can create a program for kids when they're 16 to try to understand in terms of predicting what kind of things they can learn very, very fast, that becomes very powerful at an age where things are changing at a pace which is astonishing. And so, in many ways, it gives another sort of a color of how you train people, and then just try to imagine telling 5, 6, 7, 8,000 people like Keren what to do every morning.
That was your job for a few years.
Yeah, and so
anybody wants his job.
The thing about that is that you have to embrace a kind of chaos. And if you can always keep it at the edge of chaos and let people like Keren try and fail and then the vision comes from the bottom all the time. Now, because the people come in at 18 and they keep on flowing in, you have this evergreen energy of naive, extremely smart, very motivated individuals coming in and looking at the same problems from a different perspective all the time. If you can create an enabling environment for them, magic happens. And all of a sudden, things that were considered unsolvable just get solved. And it becomes an art of how you manage this organization. But if you manage it well, you create magic. And these are the people that instigate this incredible economy that Itzik was speaking about. And in many ways, we have created a situation where we were able to leverage a very difficult situation in terms of economy, because it doesn't really make sense to send everybody to the military when they're 18 instead of starting their career.
Or
instead of going to college.
We get to college and university later than our counterparts in Europe or the United States. So I only started my university, my first degree, when I was maybe 23, 24. So it does mean, it does have an impact on, you know, later stages of people's careers as well.
Yeah, specifically for cyber, and I think this is another key for cyber, it's not just about getting a second chance and the MASH and failing. It's also, in many ways, at least from my humble perspective, there are things in cyber that you cannot teach. There are things in cyber that you either experience and are a part of, or you're not. And the fact that we have an evergreen flow of very talented on-the-job training experienced individuals coming out of the military that were really on the trenches of cyber warfare for a few years is priceless.
Absolutely, I agree. And I want to point out something else that maybe for the audience would be interested is interesting as well. The side effect of having people come in through this, if you'd like, maybe a machine, a startup machine, a machine that drafts people into the army, trains them in elite technological units, and then after 3-4 years, or sometimes more, of mandatory service, releases them into the ecosystem and have those people start companies. It also means that back at the unit where they just left, there's this new, fresh ground that people can come up with new ideas. So in a way, there is not much institutional memory or history. And sometimes that's also good, because you don't have to deal with those, you know, sometimes blocks of thinking that is stuck on a previous paradigm. You can actually change paradigms very quickly. You can challenge them as you go. And for me, at least, it was very refreshing during my service as well. So I'm also curious to hear, Udi, you changed one paradigm, as we said before. You moved your company's headquarters from Tel Aviv to Boston, but you still have a lot of presence in Israel.
Yeah.
When you do that, when you take the Israeli company and you actually put it in a different situation, what makes it still stay, you know, Israeli? Does it still have that chaos, magic? My dad, who was also in the intelligence unit for many years, the same one as Nadav, my dad likes to say that our army experience is such that pressure makes diamonds. So we are under constant pressure to create, to solve, to address real-world problems and situations. And how can you maintain that in a company that is growing, that is not a startup anymore, that is not dealing with perhaps, you know, enemies on the fences, but rather saving your customers' data? It's a very different atmosphere.
So we always knew that the Israel presence is part of our edge and differentiating factor. So actually the company is still headquartered in Israel.
Mm. Okay, sorry, I got it wrong.
No, it's all right. But we moved our U.S. headquarters to Boston, and, and that was a big part of our success, is actually embracing ourselves in the biggest market opportunity very early on. But the R&D center is in Israel, and therefore we're able to continuously infuse ourselves with new blood coming out of the military computer units, and the whole concept of more veterans bringing younger graduates that are leaving the units and get that infusion you talked about, which I totally agree with. In terms of culture, it was always important for us to maintain that can-do mentality that Israelis have, and also to really be a very team-oriented and to bring that along while creating a global culture. And we now don't refer ourselves as people feel very inclusive. We have employees in 30 countries and customers in 70 countries, but they're proud of that. That element of infusion from Israel that embraced the global culture.
Yeah, Itzik, I think you want to comment on that, please.
I would like only to generalize and say that this is usually the case. I mean, some Israeli companies go to, I mean, because we are very small, we have a very small internal market, we have to go globally, and therefore going to the States is a very natural move. Still, the R&D centers are kept in Israel. And this is done not only by Israeli companies, but really, we spend something like 4.5% of our GDP on R&D. It's the first one in the world.
The most investment in R&D in the country, on a national scale.
Yeah. But what is more important to know is that out of this 4.5, 3.5, is the money comes from abroad to R&D centers in Israel. IBM and Intel, I think, were the first, but nowadays we have R&D centers of Microsoft, beside IBM and Intel, Microsoft, Cisco,
Google, Facebook, Apple, GE,
all the big
GM,
MNCs.
Lockheed Martin, list goes on.
All the big MNCs. And the reason they don't move the R&D centers from Israel to, don't know, well, Silicon Valley, for example.
Well, they already are in Silicon Valley, so they don't need.
No, I mean the groups that really develop it, not the you know, those who look for investment, things like this, they still keep them in Israel because of the culture. It's I mean the talent, of course, but talent can move from one place to another place, but the culture.
So what is the culture of innovation?
Culture is something which has some roots in the military dimensions that was mentioned here. It has some roots in Jewish culture, which is more basic. I mean, I was holding myself not to argue with my friends here on many things that they said, but this is part of the culture.
Arguing.
Yeah. We're having a conversation. Usually
debate.
When you see three Israelis speaking,
debate,
and it seems like maybe they're fighting, and you're like, oh my God, what's that aggressive situation that's taking place there? They're actually having a nice, friendly conversation.
But Itzik, I know that we will hear about it after the panel.
That's true as well. And we don't hold back.
What is more important, I think, is the element of criticism, which it's a Jewish trait which we made a kind of art. In a way, it originates in our religion. I mean, you have to read the Bible. Even the people of Israel from the Bible were complaining all the time. And this is very important because if you are satisfied with the current situation, you'll never be driven to change it and to have new technologies, including cyber technology. I mean, it's only part of it. And another element is that we know each other. I mean, again, it's because I think the military service in a way, because we met everyone, even if it was only for the minimal 3 years that is compulsory in Israel. We know each other, we can talk easily, and it's not good to move it from such a place. And therefore, what real big companies are doing are financing the R&D. In R&D centers sitting in Israel and using it for products that are produced elsewhere.
So we got a question from the audience. Somebody wants to know how the government and other governments can actually learn from startup-like innovation and how, maybe Nir, maybe you can comment on this as well, how you can actually embrace the same type of fast and dynamic pace of startups into government. And I'd like to bring up one example, which I think is important for the audience to know about, the CyberSpark, which I think it actually began with entrepreneurs, and then the government and the universities latched onto it. So I'll give you some reference. The CyberSpark is actually now a center in Be'er Sheva, in Ben Gurion University, where there's actually development projects from Lockheed Martin and RSA, and startups are there, and university is there, and the National CERT is there. But the National CERT actually got there only maybe 5 or 4 years after Lockheed Martin and the startups were already there. And I know EMC as well, and Orna Berry, who was actually a fantastic leading Israeli lady, who was once the Israeli chief scientist, she made the decision to bring EMC and RSA to Be'er Sheva because she believed in this sort of collaborative ecosystem. So how can you catch on to that as the government is kind of playing catch up with what the startup is doing?
So I think regarding the CyberSpark actually is a very good example of how we took several initiatives that were from several directions and created a kind of a national project, a big national project that incorporates, first of all, incentives from the government to multinationals and other companies to get into
the tax incentives,
for example,
okay.
And grants uniquely
grants.
to employ high qualified technology people of R&D and cybersecurity. We brought there the government entities such as the National CERT, the government SOC, and other information sharing platform. We are concentrating them. We established together with Ben Gurion University the Cyber Research Center with other multinational partners that were located there. And eventually we're going to, within the next 3 to 5 years, we're going to relocate as a country, we're going to relocate all the elite technology units to this campus. So it's
so
kind
Nadav,
of a...
Nadav's not the predecessor, but the guy who now has Nadav's job
will
have to...
He will be in the southern area.
He'll have an hour more to his morning drive.
Yeah.
Or he moves to, he might move down there. Yeah.
Yeah, it's only an hour and a half from Tel Aviv. And it's still like making part of the desert be in a kind, we call it to be the next Silicon Wadi.
Nice.
Of cybersecurity.
Very cool. All right, so we got a few more questions from the audience as well. And I wanna. This is actually a great question that I appreciate as well. The question from Emily, who's, if you're in the room, hi. She's asking, what opportunities are there for young people from maybe all over the world and in Israel to work in cybersecurity without that military experience? So can people come from all over the world and join Israeli companies? Can they join into this without having that mandatory service? Or is that, the fundamental thing that you have to have What do you guys think?
Absolutely, you don't have to have a military background service. We created over 300 jobs in the U.S.
So entry-level positions?
All over, and people are trained, and we can train. I agree that, we can't replicate the exact infusion that they get in Israel, but we can train them and give them I think one of the things that Itzik talked about, we can give them the security background and then put them in this culture of debate and culture of you can make a difference. The hierarchy doesn't matter. If you have the best idea, we'll go
so
for the best idea.
So challenging assumption,
challenging, let's
paradigms.
Go for the best idea. It doesn't matter who was right. It matters what is
right.
What works, yeah.
Friend and mentor and guru, Yossi Vardi, who is considered one of the godfathers of Israeli high tech and has been an angel investor to more than 50 companies and was one of the first investors in ICQ. He often talks about this as well, what makes the Israeli ecosystem so special. And I told him once that I think our true renewable resource is not sunshine, although we do have a lot of that, it's chutzpah. So we never run out of chutzpah, and chutzpah is the Yiddish term for, you know, that
audacity. I think is the closest thing.
Audacity, right. Yeah. For that attitude that you can always challenge assumptions.
In English, it's chutzpah.
Chutzpah. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Professor Israel, for that. Nadav, I'm curious, within Team 8, in this foundry, so how many people do you have actually on board right now? Can you tell me?
Yeah, so across the company, we have about 200 people.
And they get funding to launch companies and to run their startups in-house?
Yeah, we're trying to apropos audacity. We're trying to take a company building innovative structures that, in my humble opinion, haven't changed dramatically over the last three decades, and flip them around. And so we don't start our companies with an idea or a solution. We spent the first few months or sometimes year by looking for trouble. We have a syndicate of investors that are spread all around the world, large companies like Cisco, Microsoft, AT&T, Accenture, and others.
The former CEO of Google.
And the former,
Eric Schmidt
and the
is
former
one of your first
CEO
investors.
And current chairman of Google, Alphabet.
Okay.
Yeah, we need to be very exact.
Good. Okay.
We spend time in their socks, we spend time with their IT personnel. We travel the world, different countries, different places, and literally looking for trouble, trying to understand where the largest gaps are. What are these gaps? Where are they going? And then playing a game of perspectives and vantage points. Instead of looking at it from one perspective, trying to look at it from multiple perspectives, from the endpoint perspective, from the cloud perspective, from the attacker's perspective, based on the people that we can hire out of the military. Bring all these perspectives together in an ideation process that eventually leads into a very deep technical research and validation process. And only at the end of this journey do we actually start a company around it. And so this is a slightly different process.
And I'm curious, how many of your team actually has a similar background to you? So I've been through the elite technological units, through the military. And I should also point out, by the way, 8200 is great. It's in fact is as big as the Israeli Navy. So it is a very big unit in terms of numbers, but there's also a whole bunch of other smaller, perhaps less well-known Israeli elite technological units within the Air Force as well, and other in the intelligence force that are also creating these breeding grounds. So it's not just 8200. When
Look,
you
I
hear
think,
that name, it's
by
like
By the
a,
way, I think 8200 is renowned, and especially because of the technology, but it's not only about technology. I think technology is obviously a part of our industry. And a very very central to everything that we do in cyber, but a lot of entrepreneurship has nothing to do with technology. Mm. In fact, most of the people that we hire, we are now looking at, or we recruit, or that join us, usually go across the bar of the need to know basics about math and science and computer science, etc. What we try to look for is leadership and collaboration and agility. And for that, you don't need to go to the military. Mm. You just need to go through something. Saul Singer, who I think is one of the
authors of the Startup Nation.
One of the co-authors of Startup Nation. So he dubbed the very important phrase of Startup Nation, and now we call it Cyber Nation. Regardless, told me sometime, I think about 2 years ago, something that was an eye-opening for me. Talked to me about the Mormon tradition. Right. So Mormons, again, this is what he told me, so, and I never really checked the fact, but lot of moments when they graduate from high school, instead of going into university, have to do a year of community service.
Yeah.
And part of that community service is going around the third world country, fourth world country, whatever, and trying to go from door to door and you know, and make a good name for a moment, whatever they do. And he told me, what do you think they get? I mean, you're 18, you get plucked out of your community, you go to a country that you've never seen before, and your job is to go knocking on doors and telling people that they should listen to you about becoming Mormons. And most of the time, what do you get? Somebody just closes the door to your face. Do that for 12 months. It's a humbling experience.
It also changes the way you look at the world and creates maybe an entrepreneur even.
It's a great marketing adventure, and it's a very humbling experience. And for the entrepreneurs in the room, that's something that you should go through if you really want to make something big.
So get a lot of no's and doors slammed at you. And with that in mind, we're almost done with our session today. I want to do a lightning round. Guys, ladies in the room, and myself, and gentlemen on the stage. One quick idea, each of you, if you have a takeaway, something that the audience can take with them in their espresso coffee cup for the next thing, what can people learn? Really quickly, because they're about to throw us out the door. Nir, why don't you...
So for the government perspective, I'll give you. So first of all, what's not to do? Don't overregulate. Yeah, especially in cybersecurity. Let it be open research and open industry to just facilitate where needed.
And that's it. You had your shot.
Yeah,
that's it.
Thank you.
Don't overregulate. Yes.
I would say think big, but really create a culture that you can be challenged and questioned. And don't think about ego and who's right in hierarchy.
So as a manager, open your door, but have your people go through a lot of closed doors as well, right?
I'll take Udi's lead. In many ways, we're trying to take Udi's lead and build a big industry, but also take your lead about being gracious. And putting your ego at the right place. And I'll teach you one more Israeli or Hebrew word, which doesn't really exist, which is lefargen. Which is chutzpah is one, lefargen is other. Lefargen means be gracious. And I think...
And recognize people's achievements,
celebrate them, and say, that's
really awesome what you're doing, and we'd like to learn from you
exactly.
In a very gracious way. Very good. I think it's a very positive note to end on. With your permission, I would thank our audience, and our audience, please thank our panelists as well. Thank you very much. Thank you. My name is Keren Elazari, and you can find me online, and we'll be happy to answer some more of your questions via Twitter as well in the future. Bye-bye.